Well, why don't you go ahead and give the Lord a hand clap of praise? He's worthy of praise, amen? As they were singing that song, "Fill This Place," I was reminded of Isaiah. It said that it was in the year that King Uzziah died. Think about that for a moment. Trouble seemed to be on every side. A nation in upheaval and unrest. Death in front of them. Dealing with the situations of that moment. But he said it was in that moment is when he saw the Lord high and lifted up. So I don't know what situation you come into this house with this morning. Some kind of unrest, perhaps loss in your family or friends. We've got many that we're praying for that are dealing with sickness right now. Whatever it is, we're in a good place because these are the moments where we can look up and we can see God high and lifted up. And the Bible says his train filled the temple so much that they couldn't minister. Now, it's not that I don't want to preach. But if the Holy Ghost were to fill this house in a way that we couldn't minister and we just broke out in praise and power under his anointing, I'm okay with that because I came into this house to let God do something in my life that I don't get when I'm at work and that I don't get when I'm at Walmart and I don't get when I'm at school. I come into this house today to lift up the name of Jesus because it's in that name that all power is given. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, I guess I will preach. He said he found that cassette, and I leaned back and said to a few there, I said, I hope I'm not preaching that message. You'll turn with me in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 1. You may have a Bible app you're looking on, whatever you do there, but join with me at Genesis chapter 1, and while you're turning there, I'm going to say thank you. It's been mentioned by both Brother and Sister Ellingsworth, as well as Brother and Sister Streeter, that they are happy to have us here, and we're extremely happy to be here. We're thankful for the invitation by the Ellingsworth and by the board to be here with you. And anytime we get to spend time with some of our dearest friends, the Streeters, is a great time. So we're thankful. You've been wonderful hosts, the basket in the room, the meals. It's been great, and we're so thankful. And if you're here today and you're a longtime member, maybe you're a first-time guest, or you're somewhere in between, whether you're in this house or whether you're in your house joining us online, you've come to a good place. Not because we're here, but because God's here. He can make all the difference in your life, and that's an exciting thing today. If you are a first-time guest and you don't have a church home, you found one. I'll just say that one more time. If you are a first-time guest and you don't have a church home, you do now. It's a great place to be. I guess I better start preaching. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 is where we're going to start. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. Darkness on the face of the deep. The Spirit of God began to move upon the face of the waters, and God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. Pause for just a second and think about that. Now, I know we just kind of did a little simulation here in the house, and it probably didn't move you. Now, granted, some of you, based on what I've been hearing with the blackouts that have been going on, you might have thought the power just went off. But think about it for a minute without the context of ever having seen light. What it would be like in the moment when darkness gave way to something totally different. When light first emitted, when it first showed up and uncovered what was in front of it that had been shrouded in darkness. In that moment, with no context of brightness before it, imagine how that must have felt in the moment. I'm going to pray. I'm going to ask you to pray because I believe God has a word for us. I believe God has a clear word for us. And if I'm just preaching to me today, I need to hear what he's going to say. So let's pray together. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your word. I thank you that it is clear that your spirit is with us and your presence is here and you are moving. I ask now that as we enter into this time of prayer and presentation of the word and receiving that word, God, that our minds and our hearts would be in tune with what you have to say. And we thank you for speaking to us today. In Jesus' name. Did you notice the drastic change when things go from dark to light? When we read about the creation of the world, we find in Genesis that this contrast is the first introduction that we have. The Bible says the earth was without form. It was void. It was covered in darkness. There was no substance there. There was shape, but it was empty. There was darkness shrouding something that could potentially be. And God steps out onto the brink of the darkness and mentions the word light. And at the very breath of the word light, everything changed. Everything changed. And all of a sudden, what once was shrouded in darkness that didn't seem to exist, that seemed almost impossible. Remember, it's without form. It was void. It was empty. There was nothing really there of substance, but God unshrouded it. He uncovered it by shining light on the situation. And after he spoke light, then he began to get creative. He began to get very involved and excited about what was going on. You remember the first time you saw the ocean? Some of you may have not seen the ocean except in pictures. It took me a long time to get to the ocean. But I remember the first time I walked out from land onto sand and stood facing the enormity, the magnificence, the magnitude of an ocean. And I can remember the sense of smallness that came to me. The reality that there were things that were so much bigger and greater than I was, and that somebody was controlling it. That there was something that was stopping the waters from engulfing everything. And it brings this mindset of creation back to me. I can remember when our boys were first introduced to the ocean. And we have this picture somewhere at home and on some digital device somewhere where, is it Logan? I think it was Logan. He's standing out on the sand and he's looking at the ocean. And we're taking this picture behind him and he's just like, he's got this look of amazement. And I know that for each of us, whether it's the first time we see some amazing sight like the Grand Canyon or some landmark, or perhaps the first time you saw your spouse or your hopeful spouse, there was this sense of awe, this sense of wonder the first time you see something. You never had exposure to that before, but in that moment, think about what God began to do. Day one, darkness turns to light and day and night begin to emerge. Can you imagine? Could you imagine if you didn't know what the sun and the moon and the stars were like the first time you saw them? I mean, we get so comfortable with it. Sun just comes up, the sun just goes down. The moon just shines and it may change colors every once in a while and we may ooh and aah for a few minutes, but then we're just, it's just the moon. Stars, well, they're out tonight. Well, they're not out tonight. That's our perception. I mean, think about it. Where did all the stars go? And then it's, wow, did you see all the stars? The magnitude of them is lost often in the minutiae of what we do daily. The beauty and the power and the majesty with which happened in a week's time gave way to something that was never there. Void and formless began to be a firmament that separated waters and sky. Lines were drawn so that waters had places to go and dry land could emerge, and the two would not mix anymore unless God allowed that to happen. Think about that for a minute. How did God, in His infinite wisdom, look at the earth and go, I'm going to draw the ocean lines this way? I can't imagine standing on the brink of nothing and seeing everything. Standing on what appeared to be the beginning, but having come from the end. You see, that's the way God operates. He moves from the end back to the beginning. We start seeing things for the first time and we're in amazement. And God starts from a place of seeing everything in fulfillment and works back to how do I best start this process. Think about where God is in your life at this moment. You're seeing things and experiencing things for the first time, but God has already stepped back from where He has taken you to an expected end, and He's handing you a story, a picture, one piece at a time. And it's here in Genesis, this first introduction to an amazing God. where waters and dry land are separated, earth and seas are formed, earth begins to be clothed, what once was formless and void and darkness now has grass and trees and seed, and those then begin to feed through the light of day and the light of night and the stars and the sun and the moon, and these seasons begin to come in, and all of a sudden you begin to see life grow. Trees and plants to feed animals that are roaming on the earth. You begin to see these sea creatures that are swimming and moving. You see fowls of the air that are flying, and God then goes, now I can create man, and he puts his hands in dirt and he breathes breath into him, and man becomes a living soul. And now we've gone from darkness to creation. Darkness to rest. Because on day seven he rested. And it's in this introduction, this creation, where we meet this God of masterpieces. The God of masterpieces. He's an amazing God. And it doesn't matter what lens you look at him through, whether it's through the sun or the moon, the stars, whether it's through the land or the seas, whether it's through the animals or the fowl or the fish, whatever lens you choose to view God through, it will always come back to a moment of awe and wonder when we start where he started. It could be the simplicity of a cell or the complexity of the human body. It could be the infinite nature of the vast expanse of the universe, or it could be the finite frame of an atom. Think about that for a minute. Our God works in expanse, but he also works in singularity. He moves from this amazing cosmos position of an almighty God that's overseeing everything and controlling all things and holding the world in the palm of his hands, but he has time to show up on a Tuesday and walk with Adam and Eve in a garden. The same God who's spinning the globe is giving wisdom and advice to man who is to have dominion and to create, because he's the God of masterpieces. So with this concept firmly in mind, I read Jeremiah 29:11 when he says, "For I know the thoughts and the plans that I have for you, that I think towards you, these thoughts that are of peace and not evil." They're meant to give you an expected end. Somebody today needs to understand that your end is not in jeopardy. Think about it. God started with your end before him, before he came back and launched you on the path that you're on. It's not in question. It feels like it to us, because when sickness rattles our body, and when financial struggles come, and when marital issues arise, and when conflict and problems show up, it seems that there's a great shaking. But we need to understand that God is not swayed by what's going on in the current, because he's already come from the future. 1 Corinthians 2:9 said it this way, "Eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, and neither has it entered into the heart of man, the things that God hath prepared for them that love him." Tells me that God has plans. He has an expected end, something so big and so amazing, so awesome, that my human finite mind cannot fathom it. That's why his ways and thoughts are higher than my ways or thoughts. And if you can understand God, you're not serving a big enough God. You need to recognize that that gap between my human ability and his supernatural ability is what causes me to exalt him and lift him up, because it's in the moments when I can't see my way out, I remember he's already come from my future. I can trust him. He can lead me out. He can lead me forward. And even though I can't personally fathom the greatness of what God has planned for me, and you can't even for you, even though he shows us glimpses of that masterpiece at times, many times those glimpses may come in dreams and visions. We catch this glimpse of a masterpiece so bold, so beautiful, that sometimes it scares us. And we stop for a minute and we go, "Whoa, whoa, whoa, hold on. Is that me? Is that for me? Or surely you're telling me that about somebody else?" And we can't imagine what it is. And it's so amazing that we become afraid, or possibly even ashamed, to share it with someone, because it seems, after all, how could God do something so big with something so small, or something so magnificent with something so less? And there's a story in Genesis chapter 37 that presents this context of God working in our lives in this piece by piece way. And it's Genesis 37, starting at verse 1. It's the story of Joseph. It says this, "And Jacob dwelt in the land where his father was a stranger, the land of Canaan. These are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, who was 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren. He was and the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpha, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. And this verse says, now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children because he was his son of old age, and he made him a coat of many colors. Get this introduction to Joseph. He's a younger brother. He goes tattles to dad on everything the brothers are doing when they're not at home. Some of y'all are looking at each other. Don't be doing that. So he goes home and tattles on dad. Dad already loves him because he had him when he was older, and he's so excited to have this young son. And now he's even more excited to have him because he keeps him up to date on what the older brothers are doing. So it creates this gap of affection, not between Israel and Joseph, but between Joseph and his brothers. And this is what the Bible says in verse 3. It says he makes him a special coat, a coat of many colors. Verse 4 says, as when his brethren saw that their father loved Joseph more than all of them, they hated him so much so they couldn't even speak peaceably to him. Think about that for a minute. Couldn't even talk friendly to their own brother. Everything they had to say was contentious. There was a root inside of them because of the preferential treatment and the favor that was placed on Joseph's life that it caused them to separate from him. It caused them to push him away, to repel him. Joseph dreamed a dream, verse 5 says, and he told it to his brethren and they hated him even more. This guy, I'm telling you, he's a 17-year-old. Classic teenager. God shows him something, and the first thing he does is run to the people who's always picking on him and not happy with him and goes, guess what? God showed me. Now, look, I don't know his spirit. Maybe he didn't approach it, but I've had two teenagers. And I've got a strong sense as a youth pastor for 10 years of a bunch of other teenagers. He probably went out there and went, not only do I have a coat, but I've got a story, you know. And his brothers are like, we don't like you before, and we sure don't like you now. And he says this, listen, guys, there's this dream that I have dreamed. And we were out in the field, and we were binding sheaves. We were working out in the field. We were on the farm. We were doing what we do. We were doing the family business. And lo, the thing that I was working on rose up and stood taller than everything you were working on, and all of your stuff just bowed down to my stuff. That's a good dream. If you're Joseph, that's a good dream if you're the favored son. That's not a good dream if you're the 10 other or the 9 other brothers. And so they both, especially in the context of a generation and a society where everything went through lineage from first to last. You got to understand, this wasn't just brothers in the field having fun. There was an order. There was an hierarchical order, a lineage-based order that was in place, and they all knew their order. Number 1 got best and first. Number 2 got second and second best, and so on and so forth. And so while number 10 down here is bouncing all over with dreams and coats, people are getting unhappy. The Bible says they hated him even more for it. They challenged him. You mean you're going to reign over us? You're going to have dominion over us? Number 1, Dad would never let that happen. I imagine this is what happened. This is me, right? Not Bible. This is me. I'm stepping back. You see, I stepped back from the podium. I imagine those brothers went, not in this house. It ain't going to happen. Because he's the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob or Israel. They had heard that. They knew about great-granddaddy Abraham. They knew about granddaddy Isaac. And they knew about daddy Jacob, who is now Israel. They knew how God worked. And they're like, there ain't no way he's going to jump over 10 of us to get all the way, or 9 of us to get all the way down to number. That's just not the way it's going to happen. He's like, well, I mean, I dreamed this dream. I don't know what to do with it. It is what it is. And they hated him. So he goes back and at some point lays back down. And verse 9 says he dreams another dream. He did not learn well because the next phrase says he told it to his brethren. Sometimes God shows you things and it's best not to just run out and tell everybody. However, what happens because of those conversations and confessions at time is often used to set up what God is trying to do. Because it doesn't seem humanly wise, but God always works things together for good to them who are called according to His purpose. God didn't give Joseph a dream for no reason, so he dreams this dream, and this time he sees the sun and the moon and 11 stars bowing down to him. And he goes, I don't understand this one. Tells his brothers, and they get mad enough, they're going to kill him. That's the end result of this confession. I had a dream, and we're going to kill you. So they put him in this pit, and they're debating over what to do with him. Should we kill him? How should we kill him? I want to kill him. No, I want to kill him. How about we all just kill him at the same time? And one of them gets a little bit of wisdom and says, well, how about we don't kill him? We can tell Dad that he was murdered or he was killed by animals, and we'll do. But why don't we sell him and get a little something out of this? He's caused us enough trouble as it is. Why don't we make a little something back? And so they sell him into slavery. And so here is this 17-year-old who is ripped from his family with a God-sized dream, but with a really crazy reality in front of him. And he begins to live this life of slavery. He begins to move from land to land in this caravan until he finds himself sold into the house of Potiphar. Think about that for a minute. Go from this amazing, magnificent dream to what appears to be not an amazing and magnificent dream. You would think his brothers and family would be hoisting him on their shoulders and running him around, and he's going to be great. God's going to... It's not quite so. His family, the ones closest to him, wanted not just to kill him, but they eventually sold him. And it's in this moment that Joseph's life gets played out from this pit, and his brothers arguing over what would be his demise. It's not exactly the masterpiece that Job probably dreamed was going to happen. It's not what he saw, but it's hard to recognize in the moment, but God is giving us pieces, piece by piece. And how many times is it the same in our lives? God gives us a glimpse of something great, and the very next day the car blows up. God shows us something great, and then we get fired. God tells us this amazing thing that's going to happen, and COVID happens and shuts the church down for a while. I'm just telling you, this is life. Maybe your life isn't that way, thank God. But my life tends to be a thought process of something great that God may have shown me way back when, but then it's trudging every day with broken air conditioners, no power, and sickness, and disease, and bills, and work, and ups and downs, and happiness and trials, and joys and in mourning, and I lose people I can't explain, and I don't understand why things happen the way they do, and I find myself looking at the ones closest to me quite often, and it seems like they're plotting for my demise, and I'm going, wait a minute, the very ones that should embrace me and lift me up are the ones that are sending me off on a different path. And so it's here we find ourselves in this moment, pits of circumstances, trying to be killed by whatever's around us, or at best, sent away on a different path. And God is continuing to show us masterpieces in the distance that seem impossible in the moment. And we keep reflecting on where we are. You know how a puzzle is made? A puzzle. A puzzle is made by printing or painting or completing a full work. It's done. It's completely done. And then they take this beautiful work of art and they put it in a machine that cuts it all to pieces, literally destroys the picture. And then they bag it up in something like this and they send it out for us common people to pick up, right? Some master worked on pieces. Some master who painted something, a Van Gogh Starry Night, and it's broken down to 1,000 small cardboard pieces. Or you get some beautiful Rembrandt, or maybe you're a Thomas Kincaid light person, and you get some of that. Or maybe you're not much of a painter, and you think Picasso's really good. Hey, there's a place for abstract everything. God works out of chaos into order. But here's the deal. This once was beautiful. But when I look at that, that's a hot mess. How many of you love puzzles? Go ahead, show of hands. How many of you detest puzzles? Thank God there's some people in here who hate them. You know why we hate them? We don't want to go through the order and the process of sorting out the mess and taking the time that's necessary to put together something that looks beautiful for a moment, only to break it all back down and put it in a box and put it up again. Now, some of us enjoy it. We're analytical. We're like, give me the pieces. And we're like sitting there and we're turning them and we're looking, and we work ourselves up from 100-piece puzzles to 300-piece puzzles to 500-piece puzzles to 1,000-piece puzzles to 5,000-piece puzzles to 3D puzzles. We used to call those Legos when I was a kid, but now they make them in puzzles. But there's something about this concept that is mirrored off of the way God works in our lives. I gave the clue at the beginning when I said very simply that He starts at the end. God always starts with a completed picture. He knows the end. It's expected. That was His terms. An expected end. That means that it's fixed. It's settled. But He often walks into our everyday life and He goes, there you go, take that one. And take that one, and take that one, and take that one. And we pick that piece up and we look at it. Now, if you can see that at all, there's absolutely no distinguishing characteristics on that piece. It is a blue piece. And quite often, it's a 1,000-piece puzzle of all blue sky. And you're going, I have no clue where or how that fits. And it's got curves, and it's got edges, and it's got bumps, and you're going, my Lord. What do I do with this? And we sit there and we put it on the table and we turn it around and we try it in this spot and it doesn't fit. It doesn't work. We try another piece and try another piece and we try another piece and we try another. And piece after piece, often it takes us forever until we start getting things that seem to fit together. Think about Joseph for a minute. Think about his life. Let it sink in. If you took a snapshot anywhere in Joseph's life, you would see amazing highs and amazing lows. If you took a snapshot when he was ruling in Potiphar's house and everything that his hands touched was blessed, you would be like, that guy's got it going on. God is using him. That's amazing. And the next picture you get, he's in prison. He stood for God. And the next thing you know, he's in prison, falsely accused. Now that snapshot doesn't look pretty. If you took a picture when he's getting that coat from daddy for the first time, that's, wow, this guy's loved. He's favored. But then you take a picture of his brothers arguing about killing him in a pit. That piece doesn't seem to fit the story because, unfortunately, we live our life from piece to piece. And God simply stands back and goes, this is what you need to get to the next piece, to get to the next piece, because eventually they're all going to fit together to make something beautiful. We don't see it. He gives us glimpses. The psalmist declared it this way in Psalm 139, verses 13 through 17. He says, for you have possessed my reins. You've covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you because I am fearfully and I'm wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and my soul knows that. Get it. My soul knows it. My flesh struggles often with understanding it. But the part that came from God knows what He's doing. He knows it right well. My substance wasn't hid from you when I was made in the secret. I was curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Your eyes saw my substance even though it was imperfect. And in your book, all my members were written wherein they were in continuance in fashion when there wasn't even a one of them. How precious also are your thoughts unto me, O God, and how great is the sum of them. Notice verse 16. Your eyes saw my substance, yet being imperfect. In your book, all my members were written, which in continuance were fashioned, but there wasn't even a one of them at the time. Another translation says it this way. Your eyes saw my unformed body, and all the days that you ordained for me were written in your book before a single one of them came to be. He wrote your entire story before He created you as the main character. You got to understand that for a minute. He penned everything about your life that He had designed before He ever launched you into the earth to fulfill His plan. He's not confused by a single step or day you take. He may be frustrated because we sometimes take steps that He didn't design or desire, but He's always got a plan that He worked from the end back to the beginning. Don't let voices of despair, oppression or thoughts that are spoken into your lives from friends or family or other voices or even the enemy tell you that nothing good can come from your life, that you've gone too far or done too much or you're too little or you're too weak or you're too this or you're... God had an individual story and masterpiece for you. And then he created you to live it out. He didn't start when he looked at Brother Ellingsworth and said, well, he's there, I guess I better figure out something for him to do. Long before Brother Ellingsworth was on the earth, before he was formed in the secret place, before he was in the womb, God wrote a story and then birthed it into the world. And you need to have confidence today that while you might have stepped off the path he has for your life, his design for your life is still perfect and it's still available. All it requires is you to go, I don't understand where this piece goes, but I'm going to put it on the table and I'm going to let you help me place it. And in that moment, this one piece of the puzzle with so few distinguishing marks that makes absolutely no sense in the context of what I think God should be doing in my life, I begin to realize that I have to put it with all the other pieces that eventually fit together. From slavery to a house and power. From a house and power to prison. From prison to elevated to talk about dreams and then forgotten. I mean, how many times, if we take a snapshot in Joseph's life, was his mind and heart had to be challenged? God, you gave me a dream. I know I saw those sheaves of wheat bowing down. I know I saw stars and sun. I don't understand it. This sure doesn't look like the way it's supposed to go. But here I am. 22 to 24 years later. So we'll just say 23. In the light of 23 years, of piece after piece, pieces that don't fit, but continuing to put them together. I mean, think about how excited he must have been in Potiphar's house when things started going well. Finally! I mean, he's just like us. How many of you, something bad hits you and you go, okay, I can make it through this, and then the second thing hits. And you're like, okay, it's getting a little tougher, and you start to humanize it for yourself. Well, they say bad things come in three, so I can handle at least one more, but then number four comes. And you're like, oh, hold on just a minute. What's going on here? And then something good happens. Something turns. Something breaks. Something opens. Something closes. Whatever it is, it's good, and a piece starts fitting. Doing puzzles, man, you can sit for hours on one piece sometimes, and then you can look down and pick up three pieces, and they're already stuck together out of the box, and you're like, how did that happen? You can make more progress in one moment, sometimes by accident, than you can with hours of intention. And that's the way our lives is. Some of these pieces make no sense, and it feels like we're trudging through them for days and weeks and months, and then all of a sudden, stuff just starts happening. It's like overnight, things are great. And then you move back to the blue sky section of the puzzle and you got 47 pieces that don't look like they go together and you're working and working. 20 years, 20 plus years of Joseph putting together a puzzle that seems so broken and not working. And what happens? 20 something years later, he stands in Genesis 50:20 and he says this, you thought it for evil against me, but God meant it unto good to bring to pass this day. That's a big verse for Joseph. That's a big verse because 20 something years of living those days, it's hard to look ahead to this day. When you're in the pit, the palace seems so far away. When you're in prison, it doesn't seem like the king is ever going to do anything except maybe remove your head. When you're being lied about and made fun of and talked about and mocked, it doesn't seem like the standing for God makes a whole lot of sense. Because piece by piece and day by day, any moment can be high and low. But there is an expected end. 20 plus years, Joseph put piece after piece together consistently, not understanding where he was going, but from the beginning he had a vision of what God could do, and realization hits him 20 something years later. It was all for this day. This day. From that moment forward, we read about no struggle in Joseph's life. I'm not saying it doesn't exist. Not saying it didn't there. But the Bible doesn't show it to us. That moment forward, he moves his family into a land of provision. He raises his father into an old age. And I say raises his father because when you've got aging parents and you begin to work with them, it's like raising kids again. And you know what? There's joy in it. And the Bible says that Joseph was happy to have his dad there, and his dad was happy to be with him. And all these brothers who hated him and were rebellious and didn't like him for all those years had no problem being subservient to number 10 over here, number 11. Think about that for me. This day, 20 plus years of pieces that made no sense to come to a godly recognition of what God had planned this day to save much people alive. A glimpse through 20 years of pieces to a masterpiece that gets revealed that doesn't only save his family, but it saves an ungodly nation and it saves a godly nation. Wow. What impact are you having on the lives of those around you right now in pit moments and in prison moments? And God has given you pieces that make absolutely no sense, but they're to save much alive. There will be a this day moment for anyone who follows the plan of God. There will be, because there is an expected end. He did not start your life without having it settled before. Now, again, we have free will. We can step off paths, we can do whatever, and God in his infinite ability to know all things, and he's a great compartmentalizer, because if I knew all things, I wouldn't be very helpful to some people. But he is. He's still every day knocking on a heart door going, if you'll just open the door, if you'll just step back on the path, I promise you this isn't the way I originally designed for you to go, but I'm really good at getting you back on the right path. I can get you there. It's amazing how he can make on-ramps onto destiny's road right in the middle of deserts. He can cause you in a moment of destruction and falling to simply one step and all of a sudden it's right in front of you. It's unbelievable how he's good at that. But we can't get lost in the peace of today and forget that there's a this day coming. There's an end in sight. It's there. It may be 20 years. And that may not be what you wanted to hear this morning. You may have come into this house wanting a man of God to stand up here under the weight of an anointing that he's placed on him to say, tomorrow's it, Brother Mark. Tomorrow it's going to happen. Unfortunately, I don't have that message. But what I have is a consistent and faithful God who stepped back from your end to your beginning to walk with you through the process of taking you where he has a great design for you. There will be pieces of pain along the way, and there will be pieces of joy. There will be moments that make no sense and moments that seem to be clear as day. There will be clusters that begin to form in one corner and big voids and gaps in the middle. But eventually, piece after piece, if you plod along and if you keep moving on the promises of God, they all begin to tie together until that glorious day when you find the last piece and you go, it's gonna work right here. And then you start singing songs like, it's going to be worth it after all. After every long trial and long mile, and it's going to be worth it some beautiful, happy day. There's going to be a this day moment. Why don't you stand with me this morning? From a glimpse of a masterpiece in a dream around 17 years old, 20 plus years of up and downs, in the palace of a foreign country, what would have happened if anywhere along the way Joseph just went, that's it. I'm done. Because all Joseph knew is what was going on in his life. His context was limited to his moment. He had a vision of something great, but he had no clue how or why that was going to play out and when it was going to happen. So he just had to live in the moment. And I imagine there were some dark days in prison. He was human after all. And even with dreams, destiny gets very clouded when the dust and the darkness sets in. And there's those moments where you feel like you're surrounded by walls and bars and you're like, have no clue how I'm getting out of this. I have no clue what's working in my life. This makes absolutely, God, I literally just took a stand for you and said, I will be faithful to my God and faithful to my boss, and I will not cheat on him or you. I won't do it. And because of being faithful to God, he finds himself in a pit, in a prison. What if any moment the peace became so overwhelming that he stopped putting it in the puzzle? What would have happened? Because remember, his this day moment wasn't just for him. It was to save much alive. You don't know how much God is doing in you and through you. Yeah, we're concerned about what he's doing for me. I get it. I want him to work in me and through me. I want him to bless me and multiply. I want the goodness of God and the fruitfulness of God in my life. But I have to recognize that I go through what I go through, ups and downs, because my life isn't just about me. There's a much larger picture that God painted before he put me on this road. I'm preaching to somebody today. You're in the middle of something that doesn't look like it could be a masterpiece. You're fighting something right now in this service that has no sense in your life. You can't put your brain around it. You can't. And maybe you're at home, and you're probably at home sitting there going, I should be in that service, and I'm not. This makes no sense. Your current circumstance is confusing, it's frustrating, and if you only focus at this moment on what's going on, it's enough to cause you to think about stopping putting the puzzle together. You know why I know that? Because I have the same days. I have the same struggles. Yeah, they come at me maybe a little different, maybe a little different context, but there's days where I wake up and I go, I don't know that it's worth putting this puzzle together today. I've been working on this section a long time, God. If there's really something going on here, I need to find a few pieces today. And at the end of the day, sometimes I find a piece, and sometimes I find a peace speaker. Because there's an expected end. Every day I wake up and I remember that this day is not a surprise to God. What I do with it, well, I can look at it and go, you know, I think that one fits over here. Maybe he's working on my patience. You know, maybe this one fits over here. Maybe he's trying to help me be more generous. You know, maybe this time he's just trying to show me that I can't do everything. Maybe this time he's letting me see some joys and some goodness. And man, this one goes in the bucket of an amazing day. There was a win there and that was awesome. And maybe this one, I don't understand why I had to lose that. I don't understand why I had to lose them. I don't understand. And whatever the day brings, his mercies are new. He gives us strength for the journey. He's an ever-present help in the time of trouble. He gives us joy unspeakable. It's my choice. He gives me the peace. But what I do with it is what matters. How many masterpieces get left broken in pieces on this earth because people stop putting together what God has already created in a finished product? How many unrealized masterpieces go halfway completed? I'm rising on this Sunday morning to encourage somebody just like Joseph. Commit to a God who has your end in his hands. Refocus on a God who stepped out from what he had already completed and came back to start the journey with you. That's unbelievable to think that he would paint an amazing picture for me and then love me enough to not just dump a bag of pieces in my life, but to come back and grab a hold of my hand and say, I will walk with you. I will go with you. I will give you strength. I will give you power. You can overcome this. And on my darkest days, when he seems so far away, I'm reminded that Paul said in Philippians 1:6, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will finish it. He will complete. There's not a day where my challenge causes God to think it's not going to work out. There's not a day that my problem creates so much potential chaos that God goes, I don't think we can get there. God, every day is going, there's something greater, just hold on to me. There's something greater if you'll just walk with me. Why don't you close your eyes and lift your hands today? This altar's open. If you want to come and pray and commit yourselves and recommit yourselves, because we all have days where the pieces seem to cloud the masterpiece, but it's all part of the master's plan if you'll walk with him and if you'll hold his hand. As they begin to sing, why don't you worship him? Why don't you seek after him right now for a few moments? Hallelujah, Jesus. Lord, I love you, God. You're so good. You're in this house doing great and mighty things. I surrender my life to you, Lord God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. God, I love you, I love you, I love you. I love you, Jesus, I love you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. Oh, that's it. Push through for a moment. Begin to worship him. You, Jesus, right now, God, I'll walk with you. You're with me in the fire. You're with me in the water, in the flood. Hallelujah.
When I go through the rivers, I will not be drowned. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid. Promises you make.
There isn't one that's delayed.
There isn't one that is delayed. So I will not lose heart. Here I will lift my arms and start to sing into the night. My praise will call the sun to rise. Declare the battle won. Declare that it is done. When I walk through the waters, I won't be overcome. When I go through the rivers, I will not be drowned. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid. I will not feel the flame. I'll stand before the giant, declaring victory. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid. Before, always beside me, no shadow, no valley, where you won't find me, no, I am not afraid. Before me, behind me, always beside me, no shadow, no valley, where you won't find me, no, I am not afraid. Beside me, no shadow, no valley, where you won't find me, no, I am not afraid. Before me, behind me, always beside me, no shadow, no valley, where you won't find me, no, I am not afraid. I am not afraid. When I walk through the waters, I won't be overcome. When I go through the rivers, I will not be overcome. my God will make a way, so I am not afraid. When I am in the fire, I will not feel the flame. I'll stand before the giant, declaring victory. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid. Beside me, no shadow, no valley, where you won't find me, no, I am not afraid. Before me, behind me, always beside me, no shadow, no valley, where you won't find me, no, not afraid.
You go
before me, behind me, always beside me, no shadow, no valley, where you won't find me, no, I am not afraid. The waters, I won't be overcome. When I go through the rivers, I will not be drowned. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid. When I am in the fire, I will not feel the flame. I'll stand before the giant, declaring victory. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid. When I walk through the waters, I won't be overcome. When I go through the rivers, I will not be drowned. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid. When I am in the fire, I will not feel the flame. I'll stand before the giant, declaring victory. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid.
Isn't it good to be reminded that every stumble along the road, every little detour that you didn't want to take, every load that got dumped on you, all has a purpose. Had he never gotten into prison, he would never have met the people that elevated him to the palace. And I don't like that story. I want to follow my will, thought out plan that prevents injury, insult, pain, emotional damage. But God uses all these pieces. It's a marvelous message and reminder today. For the white has scattered some pieces around here. If you want to take one of these and keep it in your pocket or your purse, tape it to the bathroom mirror. Do something to just remind you that today's just another piece. Another piece. Good way to remember that every day matters and it counts. You're not wasting time, folks. God's not playing games with you. Every day counts. The point that Brother White just touched and moved off of, at the end, everything was pointing, not that God wanted Joseph to have a nice comfy house and a wonderful life and existence. He wanted to save many people. And if you and I will realize, it's not about how much we can accumulate. It's not about how handsome I am, or it's about how can God use me to build this church. that he's building. And I'm not talking about just this one here. I'm talking about people's lives that are being touched by what we do and what we say. And it's not about us, but God's doing a great work through us. So grab you a piece and let's remember together that God is at work. I'm going to let you sit down for just a minute because I'm going to make just a couple of announcements.